afternoon. Welcome, welcome, welcome. I am excited to invite you to the Queen Vessels for the King. Oh my goodness, for the King? Oh, this incredible, incomparable King that we serve, King Jesus. I want you to know that you are a queen. I need you to just put it in the chat. Come on, put it in the chat. I'm a queen. Everybody, all the women in my family are a queen. Yes, we have to learn how to put it in the atmosphere. So, but before we go further, I want to give a shout out to my queen, DJ. So today is a day with yours truly, Lady Karen Clark Sheard. But first, let me give deference to the presiding bishop of the Church of God in Christ, and that would be my husband, Bishop J. Drew Sheard, my rock. So I, along with my few special guests, are going to talk about a few topics that are vitally important to our church and the communities we serve. And that topic is our mental health. I think that the church has a crucial role to play in this conversation as it plays out nationally in the wake of coronavirus and the pandemic. Thankfully, this topic is now getting the attention it needs. And I think that the church has to be vocal and lend its voice and influences on this important topic. I know you agree with me. Last year, the National Alliance of Mental Illness published an article stating that the Black church has been one of the oldest and at times the only emotional outlet for our community. Think about it. How many times have you reached out to your pastor, your first lady, a prayer partner for advice or even for assistance when you were feeling overwhelmed and distraught or even happy? 2 Timothy 2:21 says that if a man therefore purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified and meet for the master's use, and prepared unto every good work. Ladies, we are queen vessels for the King. Come on, put it in the chat, put it in your atmosphere, but we want you to be okay. And I believe the Lord has given us a few other tools to help us through this journey. Queen.
He brought me through hard trials. He brought me through tribulations. Never let a day go by and not realize. Had not been for the Lord who was on my side.
Well, first things first, I cannot invite my special guest into the conversation without doing something very special for a few of the women whom I admired. I want to recognize these women because they have laid the foundation for success, virtue, holiness. So let's start with our first queen vessel, Lady Mae Blake.
Now, most women can do exceptionally well under ideal circumstances. However, the real test of you, the real test of you as a woman and your uniqueness and how you survive is how you deal and cope with the difficult. And I normally say we can hang in, we can hang out, we can hang on, we can hang loose, we can hang tight, and I can do this now, and we can hang tough.
Lady Mae's effervescent beauty and grace radiates, and we are grateful for her. Let's also honor our second queen vessel. Mother Willie Mae Rivers has worked diligently for many years in our great church. We thank her for her leadership, insightfulness, and brilliance. And finally, our last queen vessel, our very own General Supervisor of the Women's Department of the Church of God in Christ, Mother Barbara McCool Lewis.
Good afternoon, everybody. Honor to our presiding bishop and chief apostle, Bishop J. Drew Sheard. Oh, how we are praying for our leader as he delivers his first official day message in this 113th High Holy Day, Holy Convocation on tomorrow. To our most gracious and loving fragrance of the Church of God in Christ, our First Lady, Lady Karen Clark Sheard. Congratulations, Lady Karen, for this creative, innovative session, Queen Vessels of the King. Yes, there's so many concerns, so many issues women face today. All of us remain cautious of the COVID-19 and its variants. We're almost there, but not yet. We cannot yet say we're in the post-pandemic era. Then there is grief and recovery. Young mothers have concerns for their children. Vaccination or no vaccination? What about their education continuing? Social interaction with other children? And then there are some of you that are adjusting to the impact the pandemic has had on professional roles, redefining your skills, working remotely at home or transitioning back to an office environment, catching up on your rent or your mortgage, restoring financial stability, maintaining healthy relationships during a season of stress, anxiety, even depression. Also, activity adjustments for us seniors who are also learning to navigate in the digital cyber hybrid world. I must say, we're doing quite well. My dear beloved daughters, be at peace. God's word strengthens us. In Psalm 62:61-2, when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Trust God. Be intentional about his purpose for your life. Clearly define your priorities, including time for self-care. Establish boundaries. Learn to say no, or thank you, not this time. Women of the Church of God in Christ, we can do all things. We can do everything. We can do anything because Christ has promised that he would strengthen us. God bless you all. I love you with the love of the Lord.
Mother Barbara McCool Lewis is a woman of holiness, excellent in administration, and leading the women to new heights. I believe in giving the women that I admire most their flowers while they can enjoy them. Ladies, thank you for the example you have set. So while I'm here, let me honor the assistant supervisors of the Church of God in Christ, Mother Wilma Huey, Mother Vanessa Gatlin, and Mother Mary Jane Walton. We love you. I am so happy you took out the time to join me today, because today we are going to be talking about some things so important to each and every one of us. We're going to be talking about your wholeness, your soul, and your mental health. And now today, I believe in loving people. We all need to love one another, supporting people and helping them to be whole. And as women, we are our sister's keeper, right? Do you believe that? Come on, let's just join together and say we are our sister's keeper. Let's welcome. I am just too ecstatic today. I am very excited to have one of my special guests, First Lady Syena Davis. She is a licensed marriage and family therapist. God bless you and welcome. Woo, Lady Davis, thank you for being here. And a very amazing woman of God. Oh, my very other special guest, Michelle Williams. She is a Grammy Award winner, artist, member of the Destiny Child group. She is an author, actress, and motivational speaker slash preacher. That was in your book. Oh, and for those of you who do not know Church of God in Christ family, she is a product of the Church of God in Christ. I love it. Oh my goodness. And she is, I'm telling you, we're glad to have you, Michelle. Thank you so much for being with me. And my other beautiful special guest, my baby that I birthed in the world. Oh, she's 30-something years old. I'm still calling her my baby. That's none other than Kiara Sheard Kelly. She is a Grammy, Dove, and Stellar Award-winning artist, an actress, an entrepreneur who's going to co-host with me. She did not know, but we're going to put her on the spot, and she does things well on the spot, so trust me. Okay, ladies, let's jump right into it, to this first topic. I'm not okay. The signs of mental illness. Lady Davis, when should we know that something is wrong with us?
Well, we begin to operate out of what is typical for us in our body, in our mind, and in our spirit. We tend to have some type of physical reaction, whether our heart rate increases or muscle tension or headaches, that typically doesn't happen to us. We may stop engaging with our friends and family, coworkers. We lose interest in things that we enjoy, and we typically begin to avoid and shut down in ways that just isn't our normal behavior.
So those are the red flags that we need to watch out for. When you see your loved ones and you see those signs, it's very important that you be attentive to that. So this is so important to me because, and it's a serious matter. Michelle, of course, you are the author of the book entitled Check In. And oh my goodness, when I tell you I read through it and it was such, that's the epitome of you saying to yourself and saying to people, my misery was my ministry. And I want to thank you for being so open in sharing about mental illness. So what are the signs? Can you tell me what some of the signs are?
Well, first of all, thank you so much for that, Lady Karen. The signs of depression, like Lady Davis was saying, could be loss of interest. You don't want to talk to your friends. You're isolating. Mm-hmm. Some of the physical symptoms can be weight loss, weight gain. So I know for me, it was definitely isolation. We trace the symptoms back to the seventh grade. Mm. So in your children, their grades might drop. Mm. So isolation, parents might think, oh, my child just thinks they've grown. They just want to be in their room all day. But make sure that maybe, are they sleeping? Mm. Make sure something hasn't been going on in their day. So I know we've been talking about adults a lot, but I also want us to get back to when we first noticed my symptoms was way back in the seventh grade. Now, back up to adulthood, you take those same symptoms into adulthood or how you used to cope or how I coped from the seventh grade up until my 30s when I got the diagnosis of depression. Mm-hmm. So now you're trying to unlearn those behaviors mm-hmm. and be around people. Because to this day, mm-hmm. I do like my solitude. Mm-hmm. So I would say those are definitely some of the signs.
Wow. It's just so amazing to me because when you think of a woman of your caliber, have all of this going on, much success, that has transpired in your life and to see that, you know, everybody see you on a pedestal, but wow, to know that you went through something like this. And the most important thing is that you're sharing it because it's people out there that may perhaps need to know that it doesn't have a name on it. You know, it can happen to anybody.
It can happen to any race, culture, any income, tax bracket. It can find you. But the great thing is now we have resources to where it shouldn't cripple. I shouldn't say that, but
you know what you mean.
Having the you have the tools and know what you need to prayerfully get up out of it.
That's most important. So, Lady Davis, is depression directly associated with mental health crisis?
It is, and not with all mental health crisis, though. Mm-hmm. But there are certain symptoms that you need to look for. For example, you need to experience depressed mood or loss of interest for at least 2 weeks. Wow. That's part of it. And then you need to have at least 5 of the symptoms that I'm about to mention for it to be clinical. So psychomotor agitation, psychomotor retardation, insomnia, hyperinsomnia, weight loss, weight gain, thoughts of death, suicide ideation. You may also have fatigue or irritability. You may also have mood swings as well. And so you won't experience necessarily all of those. And also muscle tension, but at least 5 of them will be present in you for a clinical diagnosis of depression.
It's surprisingly that you say that, because we would think that it happens outside of the church, but this is happening inside of the church.
And I might add, Lady Shear, that this disrupts how you live. So this isn't just a moment where I'm feeling sad, but this is going to disrupt how you're working. This is going to disrupt your social interaction and just other important areas of how we function in our day-to-day lives. This disrupts all of that.
Wow.
And when you talk about disrupting your life, you could notice someone who used to always keep themselves together, and then you kind of notice something is different. You literally don't want to do your hair. You literally don't want to wake up and take a bath. That's how heavy depression can be. But I want to just say something. I feel like, too, in church, things can happen. Do you agree with depression being a response to, say, the loss of a loved one, the loss of a job, versus it being an illness? Because I wonder if some people are afraid to say what they're going through because they'll be labeled as having an illness.
So the interesting thing, you bring up loss, which is in the DSM-5 connected to depression as part of sort of the not typical way to grieve or bereave the loss of a loved one. However, we do experience grief, and depression can be a part of that. And so grief is just a very normal adaptive response to loss of any kind. So loss of relationship, loss of job, loss of a loved one, loss of an experience. And we can tend to experience depression with it. Depression can kind of bring cousins along, right? Depression can bring anxiety with it. That's a very typical dual diagnosis that people experience, where they are unable to control worry, unable to function without anticipating. One theorist says we overestimate the danger and we underestimate our coping skills, and we tend to really just avoid certain interactions. And so we could be in church service and all of a sudden, you know, the person that you normally would greet, they're avoiding. They're in and they're out, you know, trying to avoid that contact. Not just because COVID, but just avoid that contact because they're really anxious, or they are experiencing depression in some kind of way.
I think that's why it's so important that we stay connected.
Yes.
Because sometimes God can give to you discernment to pick up on those spirits. I believe that. That's the way God works. That's the way we work as far as being in the body of Christ. Mm-hmm. And it's amazing that you said regarding the contact, because I'm going to be honest. I've had moments where maybe I sang a song and I felt like I didn't do a good job. Mm. I went home worried. I'm like depressed about. So it's just even those little foxes can sometimes destroy that vine as well. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, we all have gone through some moments. So this is so important.
Absolutely. So can I ask, if I can, when we know these things are happening, how do we cope, like, with basically our second topic? For example, how First Lady talked about, we'll go and do this. It could be the small thing. So maybe I'm not achieving something on our jobs. How do we avoid those little nuances that can turn into big things? Because, you know, sometimes we'll be like, oh, I'm kind of in a funk here, and it kind of blows up, and it's like I couldn't get control of it. Or like, I love how you said, Dr. Davis, where you said it comes with, depression comes with cousins and nieces and nephews. So how do we break that up? How do we address it? And can you also share with us, as people of faith, it's not always just going to church. Why should we go talk to a therapist?
So great question. Yes. First, we got to notice what's happening in our body. Mm-hmm. Our body is going to give us a signal that something isn't right. So, for example, we might have an irregular breathing pattern, like our normal breathing pattern shifts, or we have increased heart rate, migraines, headaches, muscle tension. Mm-hmm. You know, some of us go get massages, and our masseuse has to, like, really work out those knots in our muscles. So we got to pay attention to our body. Flutterings in our stomach. We might have numbness going down one side of the body. We need to pay attention to our body and not ignore that, because typically that is connected to what our thoughts are doing. What are we eating? Mm-hmm. You know, are we eating sort of that binge eating? That is a clue, because we might be eating healthy, and all of a sudden we're just indulging. We're eating, not even hungry, but just consuming. And we need to pay attention to that. And so one way we can begin to kind of cope is to really tune in to every area. So we're made up of body, soul, and spirit. And we need to attend to that like we do our hygiene. So every day we need to do something about our body. So exercise, that helps keep stress out of our body, helps change our mood, helps cleanse the mind. We need to make sure we're drinking water. You know, how much water have you consumed in a day? Are you eating healthy? Pay attention to the types of foods you're eating. We need to also pay attention to our thoughts. Are we living Philippians 4 and 8? Are we thinking on those things that are lovely, that are true, that are honest, that are just? Have we brought the thoughts captive, 2 Corinthians tells us in 10 and 5 and 6? Are we casting down those imaginations? You know, we've got to pay attention to how we are thinking and really be in tune and not ignore when we go on, you know, a tangent. We might have 10 thoughts in to, oh my gosh, I'm not this, and oh my gosh, and this didn't go out, and oh, what if, and what if, and what if. At some point, we got to go, okay, I got to interrupt this. Because I'm not even giving space to the Holy Spirit to speak to me, because my flesh or my own mind is really scattered and chaotic right now. And so I might need to just sit still for a moment. And so when the anxieties, the Psalms talk about when the anxieties multiply within us, we got to allow God's comfort to delight our souls. So how do we do that? We can ask a therapist. I often tell people, therapists help you to live the word of God. We're going to teach you strategies on how to set healthy boundaries for your thoughts, how to bring those thoughts captive and not let them go all over the place. We're going to help you love your neighbor as yourself, because sometimes we love neighbor here, but we're loving self down here. So we help you to bring that up so you're congruent with your values and congruent with your thoughts. So if you're saying God's first, but then you're making decisions that don't quite line it up, so a therapist is going to call you out on that and say, okay, if these are your values, these are your wants, these are your needs, but then your decisions kind of fall out of those boundaries, let's get you back in there, okay? And so you need to pay attention to you every single day. Mm-hmm. You know, we're to be praying, we're to be fasting, we're to be reading the word. But when we leave our prayer closet, how are we thinking in the day? Mm-hmm. How are we praying without ceasing
yes.
in our day?
Yes.
You know, where are our thoughts going? And so it's so important for us to tune in. And so we can use the word of God to help us capture it.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes.
Test your thoughts.
Yes.
You know, check your thoughts and find out, what am I telling myself? Mm-hmm. Now, if my girlfriend called me, I would be encouraging her right now. Mm-hmm. Am I encouraging myself right now mm-hmm. when my thoughts are kind of going a little haywire?
Yes.
So it's important for us to use the word of God. Talk to someone, talk to our friends.
Mm-hmm.
It's important for us to make sure that what we're telling ourselves is how we really want to live it out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the Bible is right. Mm-hmm. As we think, that's how we are. And so if our thoughts continue to be toxic, we need to do something different.
You know, it's something that you, because I was just getting ready to ask, how do we obtain a therapist, and you had already mentioned that.
Mm-hmm.
One thing that I must just bring to attention in your book, Michelle, I'm telling you, it was just so powerful. There was a moment during your depression that your mother noticed something.
Mm-hmm.
And many times we can see things in our family members
mm-hmm.
and bypass it and ignore it. But if you see something, as you have already stated, bring attention to it, seek out help. And that's what your mother did.
Absolutely. And when your mother or a family member maybe approaches you about it, one of the other signs of depression and anxiety is you can maybe be a little defensive
mm-hmm.
versus putting that wall down
mm-hmm.
saying, you right, I have been struggling, I have been mm-hmm. a little sad.
Mm-hmm.
And when you have the wall up, it comes with some shame.
Yeah.
Because you don't want to admit that you've been a little sad a little longer, or you just don't know what it is, but
mm-hmm.
you know something has not been right in how you've been responding and how you've been acting.
Mm-hmm. So it's okay.
It really is okay. It really is okay. Now, I will say, though, what's not okay
mm-hmm.
is when you are in that state, and I have to admit, when I was in that state of
mm-hmm.
hurting people with words,
actions,
when someone is trying to help you, so just make sure that it's not an excuse to continue inflicting pain on people.
Mm, yeah, I appreciate that. I have to commend your mother, because if we don't notice those signs and do anything about it, it's so we believe in prayer. We're
yes.
not taking anything away
no, we're
from
not.
Getting on our knees and going to God, because we know that He is that great healer. But
yes.
we are to watch and pray
mm-hmm.
and go seek help.
Yes.
And the wonderful thing I love about being in this great church is that God has blessed our church to use professionalism.
Mm-hmm.
It's okay. And I love the way you incorporated the spiritual side of it and the professional side of it. And when I tell you that it is okay for you to go out and seek help. Okay, so before we go further, I have to mention this part in your book, Michelle. In chapter 2, it says, you had quoted, I didn't even know that insurance covered a good portion of each session. I was clueless, but mama, you know now, when she said this, we all have encountered a situation with mama. You said, but mama said I needed to go, and my mama is not someone I like to cross to this day. So I went, and the direction of my life changed forever.
Yes, yes. Thank you for bringing that up, because a lot of people feel like therapy, you can't afford it.
Mm-hmm.
So, yes, there are certain insurances, if your therapist will take insurance, but
mm-hmm.
a lot will take insurance. And to the students in college,
mm-hmm.
there are some colleges where maybe 10 to 12 sessions, I can't remember if it's per semester or per year,
mm-hmm.
where you can get counseling while you are in school
wow.
as well. So private pay, insurance or colleges will provide therapy for free.
Wow, mm-hmm. Thank you for that information. So someone needs to know that there, listen, it's some help out there for you. Okay, let us move further. So why do you think mental health has been a taboo in the Black church?
I think it has been a taboo, but we've progressed over time, I would say tremendously, because we've become more aware of the significance when it comes to mental health and us needing a therapist and things of that sort. But I would say one of the taboos, or one of the things that I remembered as a child growing up in the church, is they would say in a minute, you need to be delivered. And that was just it. Right. And it was like, I need to be delivered, but I think it's a process to that way of deliverance. And I don't just think it is me just being there at the altar. That's a part of it. But I think that it also comes with a therapist that is filled with the scriptures that can guide me on how to unravel. Like, I had to grow and understand that therapy and revival is not just in the church. It is in the church, but sometimes it's sitting there on that couch talking to a woman of the cloth who can say, let me help you unravel this. Now, you said this, I noticed this behavior. And then the Bible talks about how the Father gave us physicians. So why not go to a professional who has study this so I can see that, like you said this, but you did something different, you know? And I think that is something that we are growing away from. And I'm proud of our church because we have educated women like yourself, Lady Davis, and First Lady, who have a desire to, you know, support other leading women and pastors as well, to have this on your platform. And then Michelle, for you to be as transparent. So I'm proud of us. Like,
know,
shout
right?
out to the church.
Yes. Exactly. And not only the church, but the denomination I was raised in, Church of God in Christ, for this to be a topic on a worldwide platform. Mm-hmm. So, Lady Shear, thank you so much.
Thank you.
And Lady Davis, while you were talking, I was thinking of a quote. Dr. Anita Phillips says, prayer is a weapon, therapy is a strategy. Prayer is
that.
A weapon, therapy is a strategy.
Yes.
So therapy and Jesus can go together.
Absolutely.
Therapy and the Word can go together. We no longer have to sweep things under the rug.
Mm-hmm.
We no longer, because when you look up under your rug, it's filthy.
Come on. Mm-hmm.
Let's clean it up. Let's clean it out.
Yes, clean that mind out.
Yes,
I think also we are finally equating physical health and mental health in the same plane. Mm-hmm. So if we got a cancer diagnosis, or if we found a lump in our breast, it's breast cancer, where does mm-hmm. we would go right to the doctor immediately and find out, is this cancerous or not? Mm-hmm. And with mental health, I think we're beginning to have that conversation. This is just like going to our medical doctor.
Yes.
We need to go get help when we find out that something isn't
so
quite
good.
Right.
Can I add to that too, First Lady? I think as a young woman growing up in the church, sometimes we underestimated our leading women. Like Lady Davis and yourself and Michelle, like, oh, they the seasoned saints. No, they got some answers for you. And they have some answers from you from, how can I say it? Not a natural perspective, but an everyday or practical perspective.
Absolutely.
And then I also can plead the blood of Jesus and say, the devil, get out of your mind. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And the scripture that resonates with me when it comes to mental health is, confess your faults one to another that you may receive healing. Then it says, the prayers of the righteous availeth much.
Mm.
And that scripture, I used to think the prayers of the righteous availeth much was about me getting my check. But the scripture is telling me that I need to go talk to a righteous individual about what's happening in my mind, and my healing will come as I talk about it. So I hope that we as a church, we as a free people, are actually operating in that freedom and that liberty that the Father has given us, and that He's just said, go for it, talk about it, but talk to the right person. Because the righteous person will give you, they'll have discretion, they'll have wisdom, and, you know, and not tell your business. That's what I think we're concerned about, which we were just chatting about that.
Think people that are pastors' wives.
Yes.
You don't want to go sit with the counselor, especially if you're a high profile. Like, you want all my business before you know it. But at the same time, mm-hmm. It's time to get rid of this facade.
Yes.
That everything is okay.
Yes.
Maybe people need to know the human side of you.
Yes.
That you have been going through something, or that you never quite dealt with this loss, or say with the pandemic.
Yeah.
That's a loss of connection with your members.
Absolutely.
You know, so I would say it is okay to say, you know, God has been blessing, God has been kind, but it's been a struggle not to be able to touch the people.
Absolutely.
And it's okay to say that. And people, I it's like I lean into a person more when they give me a little bit
of
humanity.
Yeah.
Let me know you've been.
Not all of
that's
us.
Fine.
Some stuff we might not.
Well, no. That is so true, though. You're right, because, I mean, we've had moments, and I'm sure the pastors and the pastors, just like you said, we had moments. We missed our church family, our church congregation, because we were not only missing them, but we were worried about them.
Yeah.
And we was in that house, I mean, during that pandemic, praying, Lord Jesus, we got to get to them. But that's all we had at the time. And I just wanted to mention that also while Kiara was talking, when you had mentioned something, Kiara was so quick to say, you know what? I mean, it could be if he coughing too much, daddy, we're going to see a counselor. I mean, she'll tell each one, you got to run in your stocking. We're going to see a counselor. I mean, she will. So it's good to have somebody in your life like that, that will be watching over you both spiritually and naturally. So, so fear not. If you talk about it, whatever it is, if you are laboring and you feel like it's troublesome sometimes, it's okay to say no. Am I right?
Absolutely.
It's okay to say no sometimes,
yes,
because sometimes it could lead to depression because you're giving and giving and giving and have no intake.
Yes, ma'am.
So it's important. So those of you that are laboring in the vineyard, it's okay to relax, pray. It's okay to pause. Don't stop praying, though. Don't stop praying.
I wanted to just say, First Lady is like the epitome of boundaries. And I think boundaries is something we should go into, because we always talk about how young First Lady looks. And I think that would be something great to hear
because
from you.
Boundaries
are so vital.
Boundaries
are
so vital.
Because you don't, you say, mom is so good at saying no or under promising. And I feel like sometimes we over promise. But even mama, she'll act like, you know, her phone is, she's unavailable. But I strongly believe that she really knows how to work the do not disturb. But
that's why you wouldn't aim for my
phone. Exactly.
And that's her business.
And right. Okay, but can we
just. That is a good, you make an excellent point.
Yes.
Boundaries are vital.
I was going to say, I think you should respond to that, First Lady, and share how you set your boundaries. You're really good at that. Like, everybody that's in your life, we feel super close to you. But there are boundaries, and you almost do what I say. I call it compartmentalizing. Like, you go in this department, you go in, this is your time slot, that's your time slot. You do that so well. Like, and everybody's always like, oh, them clock sisters, oh, are we going to the store? Are you the mother? I'm like, no, I'm the daughter. She's the mother. How do you do so well with that?
Well, you're right, Kiara. I think I have been an advocate for setting boundaries, even for my husband and I.
Mm-hmm.
We need to take out time, valuable time, for ourselves. Because we can, it's possible that we that are in the church can become burnt out.
Right.
Because we're not setting boundaries.
Yes, ma'am.
And it's not taking anything away from continuing our work for God.
Yeah.
But I believe that God wants us to consider wellness and wholeness.
Yes.
You know? I mean, God has not given us the spirit of fear, but a power and of love and a sound mind. So in order for me to keep my sound mind, I'm going to have to not answer that phone sometimes.
Absolutely.
Sometimes at 6 and 5 o'clock in the morning, I hope Bishop don't get me. I go in there, turn his phone off.
Oh, praise God.
You know, and I make that Monday.
Yes.
No, this is family day. because I know we worked on Sunday. So let's make, and I tell them, listen, you can call me on Tuesday.
Yeah.
Monday's not a good day, but girl, you can call me anytime on Tuesday. You know, so it's okay to say no in a nice way.
Yes, ma'am. And to your point, what I've learned from you and leaders who have boundaries, it actually eliminates that domino effect, and we defeat depression in their family and his family members, because if I don't take my moment to restore, then I'll then have a feeling of inadequacy, which then can lead to depression because I'm not fulfilling my purpose successfully. So then I feel like, well, what's wrong with me? But if I set those boundaries for everybody else, that's me loving myself enough to say, I want to deliver when it's time for me to, you know?
Yes.
And my mind is functioning. I have chills talking about it. But the no, I love how you said it. Sometimes it's the no that'll save my life.
That's so good.
Literally.
That is so good. Yeah. That is so true.
Thank you for the example.
Because you have to be refreshed. So we have to be refueled.
Yeah.
It's so important because we can give out and give out and give out. Then we empty ourselves.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
So thank you for bringing that up. I hope this is blessing you all. I really, really hope this is helping you guys. I know it's helping me. So let's take a minute out for the music ministry. That the music ministry blessed you. Michelle, let's talk about the last topic.
Yes, ma'am. Well, I'm excited to start off our final segment and talk about the importance of checking in. So the three pillars of my book, Checking In, checking in with yourself, checking in with others, and checking in with God. Mm-hmm. Now, I know the saints would say check in with God first, so in no particular order, but can I read
please do.
A chapter? Not the whole chapter, but a part of the... Is that all right?
Yes, please. Okay.
Part of checking in with yourself is becoming aware of what thoughts you're having over and over again. Mm. These are usually signs of agreements you've made about yourself internally, spiritually, mentally, and emotionally. The Bible puts it this way. The weapons of our warfare are not physical. Our weapons are divinely powerful for the destruction of fortresses. We are destroying sophisticated arguments and every exalted and proud thing that sets itself up against the true knowledge of God, and we are taking every thought and purpose captive to the obedience of Christ. Our minds, our thoughts, and the things we come into agreement on matter so much because they all work together to pull and push our lives in certain directions. The reason I talk about our thoughts and our words is a transparent moment. When I was engaged, I would say, we're not gonna make it down the aisle. We're never gonna make it down the aisle. So those words came true. Instead of me saying, why are you having these thoughts? Process why you're having those thoughts. And so be careful of the things that you say, whether good or bad, they will happen. Right. So just be careful and make sure that you're checking in with your thoughts.
Wow, this is powerful. Yeah. And I mean, you know, many times we can just omit, you know, when you say checking in, that means, listen, check in so many ways that you have already stated. So thank you so much for that. Okay, ladies, don't forget to put the fire in the chat. Fire, fire in the chat. Fire, fire in the chat. Y'all remember that song?
Yes.
Yes, and put your tips, the challenges, and areas of support that you need. And Lady Davis, I know, you know, I have been watching your 6 tips that you give. You have to go to her website. Can you give that information and share? We can't leave Pastor out, your husband. Yes. So can you give us that information?
Yes. My husband is Dr. Herbert R. Davis, the pastor, senior pastor of Nehemiah Christian Center, Church of God in Christ in Durham, North Carolina. You can follow me on Instagram at PLDavisLMFT, or you can go to my website, www.sainaldavis.com.
Oh my goodness, I am so blessed. I hope you were blessed. It certainly blessed me. I want to thank my very special guest, I'm just too excited. I want to thank you so much for being with me. Kiera, my baby, thank you for your great words that you gave today. Sharon gave, put out my secrets out there. And then also, Michelle, woman of God. Thank you for taking out the time of your busy schedule. Oh my goodness, the world is pulling at you. So thank you so much for being with me today. And Lady Davis, thank you for giving us that sound professional information and being our therapist today.
Yes.
We couldn't ask for a better person. Thank you so very much. Now, before we go, I would love for my queen vessels on this panel today to give us some good tips. I'm going to start with you, Kiera.
Good tips. Can I say what I will remember, which was from Michelle's book, and I immediately started checking in with myself when she said, if you thought that thought one too many times, that means something's going on. Stuff is going on. Yes. So I'm going to remember that because there are a lot of things that I think over and over again. And it's like, you used to tell me, snap out of it. So thank you, Michelle.
You got it, sis. You got it. I want to encourage people who you might be dealing with depression, but just know God isn't finished with your story yet. He's about to flip the page and take your journey in a different direction. But you'll miss it if you don't hold on.
Oh my goodness, so thank you. And I just want to chip in and just remind all of the pastors' wives, all of you supervisors, have these important sessions.
Yes, ma'am.
So that you can have that girl chat. Because you never know what's going on in their mind. And this is very important for you to have.
Yes, ma'am.
My takeaway is that every person attends to their body, their soul, and their spirit, and understand what's normal so that when the abnormal happens, you'll give attention to it.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Thank you. Mm-hmm. That's so powerful. Mm-hmm. Okay, ladies, I have enjoyed my time with you and my amazing time with my beautiful queen vessels up here. Yes. And listen, I want you to remember and put it in your spirit, because we're going to say it together when we come back together after yes. this pandemic. So remember the motto, together we stand, and division is not an option.
Praise the Lord, everybody. We're checking in on this evening, letting the enemy know that he can't have our mind, he can't have our joy, he can't have our happiness. We're taking back what the enemy has stolen from us. Sister Sheer, we love you on this evening, and we honor you on tonight. Come on, let's give God glory. Hallelujah. This world can't take it away. This joy that I have.
Forgot, but I must honor the bishop's wives of the Church of God in Christ and the general board members' wives and all of the queen vessels of the Church of God in Christ. I love you all.